for accompaniment. And thank you to all the members of the choir. And I'm sure there's vacancy for more. I would like to, I would like to also join the choir, maybe at some point. But then you will have to tie your cats and dogs and shut them up, and because it's bad enough when I sing in the shower. Anyway, it's good to welcome you to Five Oaks this morning. I'm glad to see some of you that I have not seen in a while. Thank you for being the flower in the garden of God to bring blessing and fragrance and color to the worship today. It's good to see visitors. I met some of you this morning, and I'm so glad you chose to come and worship with us at Five Oaks today. Five Oaks is a church where we prefer to preach the Bible and the Bible only. Five Oaks is not a church where we are focused on entertainment. We focused on spiritual growth. And I know that's one of the things that some folk tell me. They appreciate our worship. They appreciate the depth that they experience. So I thank God for the opportunity I have to serve this church family and for your love for God and His Word. And yes, God is blessing us also financially. You know, I shared with you the other day that our church on the outside, as you can see, has been nicely painted. It looks so good. And then this past week, the treasurer told me that we received a donation of $10,000 to fix a new church sign for our church. So that's going to be our next project. We are also looking at working on the mother's room to equip our mother's room better for the mothers and the foyer of our church. So those are projects ongoing. So thank you for your contributions. Thank you for supporting Five Oaks Church. And besides that, God is blessing us with a wonderful, wonderful congregation. We love all our visitors. We thank you for enriching us with your presence today. I will continue today the message on the Holy Spirit. I shared with you the first series, or the first in the series a while ago, when we spoke about glimpses of the Holy Spirit. And you know, that's what we find. When you read the Bible, you just find these glimpses of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit shows up here and there throughout the Old Testament, the New Testament, in various places, under various circumstances, and also in various conversations that we find, especially with Jesus at the end of His earthly ministry. So today we're going to focus on part two, and I am going to focus more on the chapter of John chapter 7 and the final three verses that Kiara shared with us in the scripture reading. But before we do that, I invite you to bow your heads with me, and let's ask the Holy Spirit to come and be in our midst. Heavenly Father, we cannot open your word without first inviting your Holy Spirit, who once inspired this word, to now apply and enrich our lives with it. Give us a spirit of comprehension and understanding, and help us to grasp the deep things of God in a measure whereby you've revealed it unto us, so that we can get to know our God better, that we can shape our view of God in a way that will enrich our experience and give us hope. Because we live in a time of the world's history where there's anxiety and fear and uncertainty, and where world leaders are without hope, without any workable solution to address the conflicts in the world. The more they talk about peace, the more the wars rage on. The more they send money to weaponize countries, the more the bloodshed continues. Our world has reached a point where there is no hope except the hope we have in Jesus Christ our Lord. So as we study this morning, as we open your word, bless us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. When you come to John chapter 6, it's fascinating that or John chapter 7, when we read about a feast. You know, now Jesus celebrated the feast because they were, at the time, celebrated. And it says here in verse 37 of John chapter 7, it was on the last day of that great day of the feast. Now, what feast was it? If you just go back in the chapter to verse 2, you will see it was the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles was a feast that God instructed Moses in Leviticus chapter 23, verse 42, for the Israelites to commemorate the time when God led them out of Egypt, and while they were on their way to the promised land, they had to live in tents, they had to live in a desert. So the Feast of Tabernacles was a reminder of how God cared for them during the journey to the promised land. They had to make themselves booths or shacks, and they would live in these tabernacles in Jerusalem to commemorate that. And they would have a specific variety of foods. It was a feast. It was a celebration. And I know one of the favorite delicatessens that I know I like is sliced apple dipped in honey, because that was one of the delicacies that they ate during the Feast of Tabernacles. But when the Babylonian captivity ended, the Jewish leaders included also a special kind of element into the Feast of Tabernacles. So that was, they included also a water pouring ceremony, where the priest would go each morning of the feast, walk down to the Gihon and come to the pool where Jesus said to the man, "Go and wash your eyes," and he would come back seeing, the pool of Siloam. So the priest would go and he would scoop a jug of water from the pool of Siloam, walk the way up to the temple, and then pour out the water as part of the celebration of the Feast of Tabernacles alongside the altar. Jesus took this moment to say what he said in verse 37. "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." I can imagine Jesus could see the priest pouring that water out, and the dirt and the sand and the ground just swallowing up this water. And it reminded them that in the wilderness, in the desert, there were many times when they were thirsty. There were times when they pleaded with God. They came to Marah where the water was bitter and the water was healed. They came to places where God had to instruct Moses to strike the rock and water gushed forth for them to drink. It came to the end of the journey and Moses was instructed to speak to the rock. And you know what happened? If it was a power of habit, I don't know, but maybe he lost his cool for one moment. Well, there was a man, no one on the world, with greater, what's the word, kindness than Moses. But for one spur moment, he struck the rock, and because of that, he could only see the promised land and not enter that. So whenever Jesus mentioned water, the people at the feast knew what he was talking about. He said, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." Now, this is the first time that Jesus uttered these words, because if you scroll back in John chapter 4, Jesus was talking to a Samaritan woman who came to the well of Jacob, and she was hauling water. And Jesus said to the woman, "If you come to me, I will give you water of life, that be in you a fountain that will be released, and it will continue to nourish you." And the woman said, "Lord, but wait a minute, you know, you don't even have something to scoop the water with, and the well is deep." But Jesus is talking about the water of life, the passion for the things of God. But in this particular instant in John chapter 7, Jesus now identifies what he meant when he said, "The water in you will become a fountain of life." And notice what he did. He connected it in verse 39, "But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive." I want you to look at something. Jesus is equating the work of the Holy Spirit with this water that will be unleashed in the hearts through the lives of, notice, those who would receive him. It's not for everyone. Only those who are willing to open their hearts. That's what it says. "This he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive." In other words, if you come to faith in Jesus, you invite the Holy Spirit into your heart. The moment when you surrender your life to Christ and you're willing to subject yourself to God's governance, to God's rule, to God's law, to God's way of life, the Holy Spirit comes in. And the Spirit works in you. And that's what it means, the water that's gushing forth. Because the Spirit creates in you a passion for the things of God. The Spirit creates in you the sense that you are God's child. Paul describes the book of Romans, says, for the Spirit agrees with our spirits that we are the children of God. But notice what Jesus said here. The Holy Spirit was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Does that mean the Holy Spirit was absent all along? No, because we very clearly read about the activity of the Holy Spirit throughout the Bible, and especially the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, when you come to the Old Testament in Exodus chapter 31, verse 1 through 5, well, before that even, the Bible opens in Genesis chapter 1, in the Hebrew, where it says, Ein Bereshit Hadabar, it means in the beginning when God started to create. Before there was anything, it was just a marshland, it was a mud, just a pool of mud spinning through the universe, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters of the deep, and out of that, life came forth. God spoke this world into existence, but the Holy Spirit was part of that work. Then we come to Exodus chapter 31. Now we have a situation where Moses was instructed in chapter 25 to build a sanctuary so that God could dwell among his people. But Moses had to find people who could do the work because God gave very clear and very specific instructions for how the sanctuary should be designed. And in Exodus chapter 31, you find an evidence there that a man by the name of Bezalel was filled with the Holy Spirit to do the work for the tabernacle. The Holy Spirit was at work to guide the hands, the thoughts, and the patterns as these men were working to build the sanctuary to the glory of God. Then we come to the time of the judges, and we find the Holy Spirit came upon Othniel. The Holy Spirit came upon Gideon in chapter 6, verse 34 of Judges. It came upon Jephthah in Judges 11, 29. And the Spirit, believe it or not, came over and upon Samson in chapter 13, verse 25 and 14, verse 6. Now notice, the Holy Spirit came over these people, over Othniel, over Jephthah, over Gideon, over Samson, even though these men made serious mistakes in their lives. And there's a reason why God explains this, because we and you and I can have hope. If the Spirit could still work in those people, He can work in you and me too. These were not perfect people. The Bible doesn't say God will give the Holy Spirit to those who are perfect and sinless. The Bible says Jesus is willing to give the Holy Spirit to those who believe in Him. People who have a struggle, people who go through pain, who go through misfortunes, who sometimes take one step forward and two steps backward, as it were. And we know these people were some of the worst characters in the Old Testament. Think about Samson. Well, and then we come to King Saul. Can you believe it? The first king of Israel. Well, all he did, all the evil Saul did, even at some point consulting the witch of Endor to communicate with the spirits of the dead, thinking he was talking to Samuel, which was an abomination he committed, and that caused his death the next day. But believe it or not, even in 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 1, Saul was anointed by the Spirit to be king of Israel. But then we find a very interesting trend. As these people, as these individuals started to reject God and start to rebel against God, the Spirit was withdrawn from them. And that explains why David will pray in Psalm 51. If you have your Bible with me, you can come with me to Psalm 51, where David has committed this sin, and now David is pouring out his heart in Psalm 51 in confession to God. He is aware of his sin. He knows he's in trouble. He is overladen with guilt. But look at what he says in verse 51, or rather chapter 51 and verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. David knew in the history of Samson, in the history of Saul, he had a very first-hand experience of King Saul, who tried to kill him many times. And he knew how Saul rejected the Spirit of God, and eventually the Spirit of God was withdrawn from him. Now David knew that as bad as King Saul was, David was not any better, because David committed adultery and premeditated murder, and he was fearful that God was going to take the Holy Spirit away from him. So he says, Lord, please, I confess my sin. Cleanse me, remove from me this rebelliousness, remove from my heart this pride, remove from my heart any obstacle that will prevent your Holy Spirit from working in my life. Please don't take your Spirit from me. Then we come to Jesus. And we saw how Jesus, throughout his ministry, from the time the Holy Spirit came upon him when he was rising up from the waters of baptism in the Jordan River, we read it there in Luke chapter 3, and you can go to Matthew chapter 3 and 4, and you read the scripture, when the heavens opened, the voice of God came from heaven, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased, and the Spirit in the form of a dove came and anointed Jesus, and he became Messiah to fulfill the prophecy of Daniel 8 that says there will be an anointing of Messiah through the Holy Spirit. And Jesus declared the very same in Luke chapter 4 when he came to the synagogue on the Sabbath, and he went in and he sat down, and they gave him the scroll and read from Isaiah 61. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because of what? Because he has done what? He has anointed me to bring the gospel to the poor. The anointing of the Holy Spirit was what qualified Jesus to be Messiah, to do the work he did. But now, Jesus said there's also a special working of the Holy Spirit that will come. But it was not ready. Because why? Look at John chapter 7 again, verse 39. He spoke concerning the Holy Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So if you have to unpack this verse, it says the moment when Jesus is glorified, that will prepare the way for the Holy Spirit to be poured out, right? And we know that Jesus, at the end of his life, if you continue to John chapter 17, and you come to John chapter 17 where Jesus is praying, and he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may also glorify you. When Jesus prayed for that, that means the Holy Spirit was now ready to be given to those who believe in God. Jesus said the Spirit was not yet given, because the Son was not yet glorified. But now Jesus prays and says, Father, glorify your Son, that your Son may also glorify you. And as you have given him authority over all flesh, he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Now, I shared with you already that when we look at the concept of the Trinity, I know it's very, very deep, and we cannot always in a human mind understand everything. But God gives us the statement when Jesus said, the Father is in me and I in the Father. The Father and the Son indwell each other, and the Spirit dwells in you, and the Son will dwell in you. Now, Amy, come up here for a moment, please. I want to say something to you. And I'm asking Amy to come up because I'm looking and I see she's the only girl with braided hair. So, Amy, I like your hair the way it is. But think about it this way. When you take hair, you usually take three strands of hair and you braid it in, right? Braid it in together. Now, this is what someone said to me a while ago, is the best way to understand how the three persons of the Godhead come together. The concept of indwelling, because when you look at hair that is braided, turn around. When you look at, you can turn around, I promise I won't damage your hair. When you see the hair over here, you can still distinguish the different strands, but it comes together in one. So think about this. Thank you. You can go and sit down. The Holy Spirit, the Father, the Son are like three strands of hair braided together. Three persons of the Godhead becoming one. Notice, not three gods, because we don't talk about tritheism. But three persons that form one. Jesus shared something at oneness in Genesis when he said, the husband or the man shall leave his father and his house and cleave unto his wife, and the two shall become one. Now, I know someone came to Pastor one day and said, Pastor, when we got married, you told me and my wife that we'd be one. Now we're already seven, and I have a hard time to make the finances to feed all. So the family unit is a miniature representation of what Jesus said about the oneness, although we are different individuals, but we come one. So keep that in mind. So now Jesus is praying, Father, the hour has come that you may glorify your Son, so that your Son may also glorify you. Now, what is so remarkable is from this point on, Jesus now, if you go to John chapter 14, let's go back. Now, Jesus was preparing the statements on the Holy Spirit. Jesus here gives us five very distinctive passages to describe the Holy Spirit and the outpouring of the Spirit once the Son was glorified. Now, it's interesting. John chapter 14, look at verse 15 through to verse 17. Jesus says here, if you love me, do what? Keep my commandments. So, the question is asked, what is the time of the Greek word there, keep? Does it mean, if you love me, you should keep my commandments? Is it infinitive? Or is it past tense? No, not possibly, because Jesus is talking future. Does it mean, if you love me, you keep my commandments as part of loving me? Or what is Jesus saying here? When you look at the vocabulary and look at the context and syntax, what Jesus is saying is, if you love me, you will desire to keep my commandments. That changes it, right? There's no force, there's no judgment, there is no threat involved. Jesus says, if you love me, I know you will desire to do what pleases me. So, and then Jesus says, if you desire to do what pleases me, if you love me and you want to please me, I know there's going to be a struggle because the devil will hate it, right? Because Martin Luther once said, when Melanchthon spoke to Luther, where do you think the devil is? And Luther turned to Melanchthon and said to him, Melanchthon, try and withstand the devil for 1 hour and you will soon find out where he is. Jesus knows that when people love him and they want to keep his commandments, he says, you're going to need help. And therefore he says, if you have the desire, if you are willing, if that is your intention, that you want to keep my commandments, I will pray the Father, he will send you another helper that he may abide with you forever. Jesus says, if that is a desire in your heart, if you really want to obey me, I will give you strength. I will send you a helper. And the word of a helper is the word parakletos. It comes from two Greek words, para, which means beside, and kaleo, which means to call. Which means it's one who's called to be at your side, the one to walk with you. The Bible translates it also as the advocate, or the comforter, or the helper. It's one who is with you. Jesus says, you will never be alone, I'll be with you. And then he goes on to say, the helper will come, he will abide with you forever. Now abide, remember the braided hair, right? How the Spirit works in you and Christ works in me. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. And then Jesus says in verse 18, these famous words, I will not leave you, how? Orphans. What's an orphan? What makes a person an orphan? When you have no parents. You're without any parent. But Jesus says, you will never be without a parent. Because I'll be your God. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. So here we have the beautiful assurance of the Holy Spirit abiding with us. Jesus says, if you desire to follow me, if you desire to be my disciples, if you love me, you want to keep my commandments, I will pray and ask the Father to help you in that. Because now we can connect with what Paul says in Philippians 1 verse 6, for I believe in this, brethren, that he who had begun a good work in you will continue till the day of the Lord. The Holy Spirit is working, He's guiding, He's working in us, He's abiding with us. Now we go to verse 25 of John chapter 14, and here we have the second statement of Jesus. But now I want to look at something. These things I've spoken to you, Jesus, while being present with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send you in my name, because Jesus said, I will ask the Father, he will send you the Spirit. So Jesus continues, it says, the one who the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all things that I said to you. So get this, not only do you have people who says, we love Jesus, we want to follow him, we desire to do your will. Jesus says, if you desire that, I will even lead you into deeper truth. I'll reveal more things unto you. You will begin to grow. You begin to mature. You begin to learn more things about God. We talk about a process of sanctification, which means the Spirit is working in you. He will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all things that I've said to you. Now, why is that important? Because if Jesus stopped and said, he will teach you all things, then you can agree with people who sometimes came, like a lady came to me one day and said to me, oh, pastor, I don't believe the Sabbath is important to keep anymore because the Spirit told me I can serve any day. That would be true if Jesus said the Spirit will teach you all things, but it doesn't end there. He says, and will bring to your remembrance what? All things that I have told you. So the Spirit is not going to operate separately from the teaching of Jesus. The Spirit is going to apply that which Jesus already taught. Otherwise, the Spirit and Jesus will be divided in the Godhead. Jesus says one thing and the Spirit says, oh, don't worry about, just do this. No, the Spirit will come. And then again, Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Because you know what? There is peace in the heart of the person who desires to follow God's will and to attend to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Peace comes from walking with God. Peace comes from, as Olivia said in the story this morning, Enoch walked with God. There's a peace that comes in you because the fruit of righteousness brings peace. So Jesus here tells us the Spirit will come and he will do a teaching. He will be also the teacher. Not only will he be at my side to help me in my walk with Jesus, he will expand my horizon. He'll begin to show me new things. I will grow more in relationship with Jesus. Then we come to John chapter 15, verse 26 to 27. But when the Helper comes, whom I will send you from the Father. Now wait a minute. First, Jesus says, the Father will send you the Spirit in my name. Now, look at the change here. Jesus says, but when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. And you also will bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. What is Jesus talking about here? Why is Jesus now suddenly the one sending the Spirit, but the Spirit proceeds from the Father? Well, this is where we come to the aspect of his glorification. Because it's obvious that the context here says the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father will testify of me. He will give testimony of Jesus. He will tell us something about Jesus that is important. Right? So now, when was Jesus glorified? Well, let's go to an ancient prophecy of Daniel chapter 7. Come with me to Daniel chapter 7. And Daniel sees a vision in Daniel chapter 7. First, he says in verse 9 of chapter 7, thrones put in place, the Ancient of Days was seated, his garment was white as snow, the hair of his head was pure wool, his throne was a flaming, fiery flame, his wheels a burning fire. There we have the concept of the wheel. So remember the indwelling, the wheel within a wheel. Ezekiel 1, the vision of the of God. And now he comes and says, a fiery stream issued and came before him. Thousands of thousands ministering, 10,000 times 10,000 before him. The court was seated and the books were opened. Now here we have a court scene, a judgment scene. And people believe that this points to the end of time when Jesus comes again. But now look at what Daniel says. He says, I watched then because of the sound of the pompous words and the rest of the beast. And then he said in verse 13, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Wait a minute. When did that happen? When was Jesus taken with clouds into the very presence of the Ancient of Days, which in this case is God? And they brought him near before him. And notice verse 14. Then to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one which shall not be destroyed. Where did we find this? Well, the fulfillment, we don't need to guess, cometh me to Revelation chapter 4 and 5. In Revelation chapter 4, significantly, John has just seen the vision of the seven churches in chapter 2 and chapter 3. And now, after these things, in chapter 4, verse 1 of Revelation, John says, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I heard like a trumpet speaking to me, said, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. Here we have a throne room scene. But notice something. Chapter 4 describes a throne room with the Ancient of Days, and then we come to chapter 5, and John sees in vision the one seated on the throne has in his right hand a scroll written inside and outside on the back with seven seals. And the question is asked, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? Verse 3 of Revelation 5. No one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look at it. Verse 5. But one of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the lion from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seals. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as though it had been slain. Who's this? We are in the court of heaven. We have the Ancient of Days seated. We have the one seated on the throne. And now all of a sudden, there's weeping because they can't find anyone to unloose the seals which is unfolding the plan of salvation and the promises of God in the book of Revelation. Because soon after that, we have the seven seals that's unfolded. It comes to the point where he says, I looked and behold, I saw in the midst of the throne a lamb as though it had been slain. Why is John describing a vision of a lamb as if it had been slain? Because it clearly points to Jesus after his crucifixion. He was slain at the crucifixion, the Lamb of God, slain from the foundation of the earth. But here we have Jesus in the presence of the Father, and he's standing before the Father, and he comes near the Father, and it says, he came near the Father, and he took the scroll of his right hand of him who sat on the throne. But let's not miss something important in verse 6. Not only does John see Jesus as a lamb, as though it had been slain, he also sees him as having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Now, don't lose your faith because of seven spirits. It simply describes seven functions of the Holy Spirit. Now, notice what it says. The moment that Jesus was coming to the throne and brought to the presence of the Father, it says, he was standing there also were the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Now, remember what Daniel said. Daniel said in Daniel chapter 7, when you read it, in Daniel chapter 7, it says, if I just get back there again. Daniel 7 says, then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. So, true or false, Jesus was glorified at the moment when he was enthroned in heaven in the presence of the Father. Is this what Jesus prayed about in John 17? Father, I've done the work you've sent me to do. Now the hour has come. Glorify the Son. Glorify me the glory which I had with you before the world was. When Jesus took upon himself our humanity, he set his glory aside. Not his divinity. He remained God, but he set his glory aside because man could not behold the glory of God and remain alive. But now he's ready to be glorified. He veiled his glory, and now he comes. And the Holy Spirit is sent out as a witness of that. Now, we can begin to understand why we have here in the description of Jesus in John chapter 15, verse 26, when he says, but when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father. Why? Because we read in Revelation 5, Jesus is standing with the seven spirits that sent out into all the world. Jesus says, I will send to you the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, and he will testify of me. Now, here's very important news. What is a spirit telling us about the fact that Jesus is in heaven? He's telling us that the sacrifice of Jesus at the cross is all sufficient for our salvation. Come with me to the book of Acts, chapter 2. Remember the sermon that Peter preached on the day of Pentecost? Look at verse 32. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost in fiery tongues. And Peter gets up and he says in verse 32 of Acts chapter 2, this Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear. Do you get that? Jesus is at the Father's right hand. We saw the vision in Revelation 5. He's brought to the Father. The Father signifies that the Son's sacrifice is sufficient because he can open the scrolls. He's the only one worthy in heaven and earth and under the earth to open the seals, to accomplish our salvation for us. And as a guarantee of that, the Holy Spirit is poured out and he gives the testimony of Jesus. And Peter preached and he says, this Jesus is the one who is now with the Father in the presence of heaven. When the Lord said to him, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. And look at verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said, then repent and be every one of you baptized in the name of the Son of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The power is given for the gospel to be preached when Jesus sends the Holy Spirit from heaven. So here the Holy Spirit comes, and the Holy Spirit is the one that's empowering the people to share the message of Jesus. He's assisting us. Now, when we come to John chapter 17, that is the next chapter we look at. This is number 4. In John chapter 16 and verse 7. And now, O Father, Jesus says, glorify me. Sorry, it's John chapter 16, verse 7, not 17. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. So why is it advantageous to God's people that Jesus goes back to the Father? It's advantageous because that's the only way we will receive the guarantee that that which Jesus accomplished is all sufficient for our salvation. The Holy Spirit is the guarantee or the proof of that. And look at what Jesus says. I will send you the Spirit, and when He has come, He will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. What was the first reaction of the people on the day of Pentecost when Peter preached the message and he claimed Jesus is at the right hand of God? It says they were cut to the heart and said, brethren, what shall we do? There was conviction right there. That's the work of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings conviction that we need Jesus. We need His salvation. We need His sacrifice. And He says, He will convict the world of sin because they do not believe in Me. Of righteousness because I go to My Father, you will see Me no more. And of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. When you analyze it, sin, the basis for sin is unbelief in what Jesus has done for us. You reject what Christ has done for you. And Jesus says, if you don't believe in Me, there's no hope for you. Of righteousness, because I go to My Father, you will see Me no more. Why does that mean righteousness? It means if Jesus is accepted, He's standing at the right hand of God, He's unsealing the scrolls, His sacrifice is all sufficient for you and me and our salvation. And then of sin, righteousness, and of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. The judgment is there, notice, for the ruler of the world, because His kingdom is defeated. Jesus has now glory, dominion, and power. He has restored that which Adam lost. Salvation is accomplished. There's hope for you and me. And the beauty of it is that God does this not apart from us. God does it with you and me. We are involved because the Holy Spirit is with us. He's among us. He's working in us. He's dwelling with us. So that we can now also spread the news. So that whatever we hear, we can share what the Holy Spirit tells us to do. Look at what verse 13 says. However, where the Spirit of truth has come, He will guide you into all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak. And He will tell you things to come. The Holy Spirit now reminds us of things to come. First, He solidifies our walk with God. The Holy Spirit gives us the assurance that we are children of God. The Holy Spirit reminds us of that which Jesus did for us, and that it is accepted as the only sufficient sacrifice for our sins. And then the Spirit comes, and He will tell us about things to come. And He will glorify Me, for He will take off what is Mine and let it to you. All things that the Father has are Mine. Therefore, I said that you will take of Mine and declare it to you. So, we become co-inheritors with Jesus. We become partakers of the kingdom of God because the Holy Spirit has been given to us. So, when you analyze what Jesus has done here in this passage, first of all, He said, the Holy Spirit will be at your side to give you strength, to help you in your spiritual battle. Secondly, the Holy Spirit will teach you to lead you into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. Thirdly, the Holy Spirit is the one that will come and will remind you of that which Jesus did. And that He's accepted, He's glorified. Fourthly, that the Holy Spirit will work in and through us that we can share the testimony of God that Jesus is sharing with us. And then lastly, we have the assurance that there's a preparation for a deeper experience and a preparation for the end time. That's why Jesus says He will tell you of things to come. And here's the wonderful thing. We talk about the time which we live in the world's history. I know there's fear and there's anxiety and people are looking at Bible prophecy. But here's the neat thing. When the Spirit of God is in your heart and my heart, in your life and my life, we need not fear what's happening in the world. Because God already has us in His hand. The Holy Spirit is given as a guarantee of our salvation. No wonder, and we will come to that at another time, Jesus said, the only sin that cannot be forgiven men is a sin against the Holy Spirit. Because when we reject the work of the Holy Spirit, there's nothing else God can do for us. We invite condemnation on ourselves. And that is why the Bible repeatedly, you know, it's interesting that if you look at the last chapter of the Bible, Revelation chapter 22, we find the Holy Spirit pleading there. Revelation chapter 22, and it says there in verse 17, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. God promises that to us. God has given us the Holy Spirit, that we are never alone, that in our struggle against sin, we never give up. In our condemnation, in the eyes of Satan, that we have hope because Jesus is the one who has the righteousness with the Father. My friends, the Holy Spirit is the power of God that helps us to survive the end times. Here's something you need to remember. I told you the word parakletos doesn't only mean helper, it also means advocate. But if you look at the advocate and it means it's the one that's standing next to you, it means the one who is in the immediate situation with you. So think about this. When a devil accuses you and me before God, because he's accused our brethren, when a devil accuses you of all the things you've done wrong, when the devil accuses you of all your mistakes, when the devil accuses you of all the mishaps you had, of all the promises that were broken, of all the shattered dreams, of all the things that you've messed up with, when the devil comes and he rubs in the salt in the wounds of your mishaps, the Spirit is the one who's right next to you. He's immediately connected to you. He's in your immediate presence. And the Spirit is there for the advocate with the Father. Because He is the one who is so intimately related to you that He's the only one who can defeat the accusations of the devil. Because He reminds the devil of what Jesus did for you and me. And by that, the Spirit says, come. Come, don't allow the devil to intimidate you. Don't allow the devil to make you fearful of the Holy Spirit. Don't allow the devil to intimidate you by thinking God is against you. If God is willing to send His Holy Spirit to do all these works in and through us, why would God give up on us? I thank God that you and I worship a Creator God who did not only send or came to this world to die for our sins, but who is also willing to be with us to the end. Now, I've heard people say, and this is a good Seventh Adventist, they sometimes say, but Pastor, wait. Just before the end of time, the Holy Spirit will be withdrawn, and we will stand on our own, which means you will need to be perfect or else you're toast. No, no, no. I don't read in the Bible that God will leave us alone. Jesus says, I will never leave you orphans. In Matthew 28, Jesus says, and lo, I'll be with you always till the time of tribulation, till the end. Get this, the Spirit of God will be withdrawn from the world like it happened in the time of the flood. But God's Spirit will never be withdrawn from His children. You and I will have the Spirit till the day we see Jesus come on the clouds of heaven. Because Jesus will never leave us alone, never in an hour of trial, never when He knows the devil is throwing a last attack on God's people. Jesus will never leave us alone to fight the devil in our own strength. Yes, the Spirit will be withdrawn from the world when the world refuses to listen. But those of us who have accepted Jesus and are filled with the Spirit, God's Spirit will be with us till the end. And that's the comfort we have. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you for the Holy Spirit's work. We don't talk about the Holy Spirit.